In the previous video, we covered how Edom came to be known as Jews, how Edom rose to power over the Yahudim during the Roman era, and how Edom spread into Europe and gave birth to the Sephardic Jewish community. Continuing with this video, we will cover the original phenotype of the Sephardic Jews before intermixing with the European population, and Edom and the Khazarian Jews intermixing. Esau and Jacob were twin brothers, and were also both black. As Edom rose to power over the Yahudim during the Roman era, and as the Roman Empire expanded into all the lands bordering with the Mediterranean Sea, so did Edom. Even two of Herod's sons, as mentioned before, were exiled into Europe, one to France and the other to Spain, giving birth to the Sephardic Jewish community, along with the Sidonians, who were Canaanites and also originally black. Tudor Parfit, Black Jews in Africa and the Americas, page 3. In the thinking of the time, the perceived typologies of Jews and blacks were not dissimilar. Blacks and Jews were fundamental others for Christian Europeans and were often mentioned in the same breath for that reason, and were regularly imagined to have shared ancestry. Parfit, page 4. Sir William Barrington, 1604 to 1661, the English parliamentarian soldier and writer, happened to visit a Sephardi synagogue in Amsterdam where he commented that the Jews were very dark-skinned and lascivious. They were most black and insatiably given unto women. Parfit, pages 4 to 5. In his new voyage to Italy, 1714, Francois Maximilian Mission, 1650 to 1772, the French writer and traveler confirms that the general supposition was that Jews were black when he noted that all Jews were black, although only Portuguese Jews started off black. "'Tis a vulgar error," he wrote, "that the Jews are all black, for this is only true of the Portuguese, who, marrying always among one another, beget children like themselves, and consequently the swarthiness of their complexion is entailed upon their whole race, even in the north regions." Parfit, pages 5 to 6. The idea that the Jews were black persisted into the 19th century. Robert Cox, 1791 to 1862, the controversial surgeon and anatomist and conservator of the College Museum, Edinburgh, in the mid-19th century, commented on the African character of the Jew, his muzzle-shaped mouth and face removing him from other races. The general look of the Jew was considered to be like that of the black. The contour is convex, the eyes long and fine, the outer angles running towards the temples, the brow and the nose apt to form a single convex line, and the whole physiognomy, when swarthy, as it often is, has an African look. Parfit, page 6, 19th century physical anthropologist, in general assumed that Jews had a close racial, that is, blood connection with blacks. The general consensus of the ethnological literature of the late 19th century was that Jews were black, or at least swarthy. Parfit, page 6. In some cases, Jews were considered black because they were of mixed African-Judaic race. On occasion, the blackness or darkness of the skin of the African, like the Jew, was perceived as being not only due to inheritance, but also to the effect of diseases such as syphilis. The negritude or darkness of the Jew was thus not only a mark of racial inferiority or of shared blood with Africans, but also a clear indicator of the unhealthy nature of the Jew. Parfit, page 11. In these fragmentary glimpses drawn from a variety of sources, we can see that Jews were considered to be black. To have a number of African physical qualities, and ultimately to have a good deal of African blood. Similarly, black Africans in the 19th century and before, in a vast and extraordinary number of cases, were thought to be Jews. And indeed, to have both Jewish characteristics and to be descended from ancient Israelite stock. From medieval times to the present, Jews have been thought to have black blood in their veins, and to have a number of African physical and other characteristics, including the African nose, African proportions, and African skin color. Similarly, over the span of time, in a long-running discourse, many black Africans were assumed to have Jewish blood, Jewish characteristics, Jewish looks, Jewish abilities, and Jewish habits. A.J. Rogers, Nature Knows No Color Line, page 63. Some of the noblest of the Sephardic families, aristocrats of Jewry, were Negroes. Rogers, page 63. Certain it is that the house of Braganza, with all the descendants in Europe of King John I of Portugal, have Jewish blood in their veins. Rogers, page 66. Race mixture was so common in Portugal that even the royal family was mulatto. John IV shows evident Negro strain, and John VI was described as a dark mulatto by the French Duchess de Abrantes, who was at his court. Rogers, page 122. Most of the Negro strain in Northern Europe and Russia was taken in by the Jews, who, in spite of the religious prejudice against them, intermarried with Christians, as Maurice Fishberg, in his comprehensive study, The Jew, has shown. And says Hertz, innumerable aristocrats have married Jewesses. Rogers, page 123. Whites says, an interesting graduation of all shades down to the black is exhibited by the Jews. Especially dark were the Jews of Spain and Portugal. The Portuguese Jews were very dark, says Pritchard. The Duchess de Abrantes, wife of Napoleon's ambassador to Portugal, said that the Jew, the Negro, and the Portuguese could be seen in a single person. Rogers, page 123. So dark were the Jews, especially of Portugal and southern Spain, that many whites thought all Jews were black or dark. This belief, said Barbot, shows what an error most people are in, since he says the German Jews, as for example, those of Prague, are as white as most of their German countrymen. Jack Bernstein, The Life of an American Jew in Racist Marxist Israel, page 39. You will recall that I mentioned my troubles in Israel began when I, an Ashkenazi Jew, married a Sephardic Jewess. Anti-Sephardic treatment by Ashkenazi Jews is even official government policy. This racism runs very deep in Israel and sharply divides the Jewish population. One day I entered a cafe in Tel Aviv. The place was crowded and I sat down on the only seat available. Also sitting at this table were five Sephardic Jews from Morocco. They learned that I was studying the Hebrew language, so they were helping me with my studies when a blue-eyed Nazi-type Israeli police officer walked into the cafe. He ordered me to get away from those kushim. Kushim in Hebrew means niggers. Tudor Parfit, Black Jews in Africa and the Americas, page 10. The discourse suggesting that Jews were black continued, and if anything, gained momentum. In the United States and also in South Africa in the first decades of the 20th century, immigrant Jews were confronted with the question whether the Jews long depicted as dark or black were racially to do with Africa or Europe, and this inevitably caused consternation. Both in the United States and South Africa, Jews were certainly not perceived as white until around the time of the Second World War. Zion Zohar, Sephardic and Mizrahi Jewry, page 239. An investigation of early modern Jewish-Black relations show how Jews shared the denigrating anti-Black attitudes and behavior of their host societies. Whether Catholic or Protestant, how Jews wielded anti-Black discourse as a means of positioning themselves as insiders, as whites, and how Black slaves constituted an opportunity for Jews to obtain the kind of servile labor forbidden to them from among the members of their Muslim or Christian societies. Zohar, page 243. Blacks after the 15th century thus provided a more specific textual fulcrum for the working out of Sephardic self-identity. They served two opposite purposes in the triangulation of national or ethnic desires and repulsions. On the other hand, Jews were able to argue their own whiteness. Zohar, page 246. Numerous early modern travelers noted the blackness of Jews, especially Sephardim, in a manner wavering between the physical and metaphysical. By the 17th century, whiteness carried quite real social effects, such as determining one's profession, what organization one could join, and whom one could marry, even in the European metropolises, lacking enormous populations of black slaves. Various pieces of evidence conveyed the impression that Sephardim in these regions actively attempted to prove their whiteness. Mission agreed that Portuguese Jews were extremely dark. It became essential to refute the problematic blackness often assigned to Jews. Hugh Thomas, The Slave Trade, page 118. In the 1550s, the outstanding mercantile family in Sevilla were the Jorges, also Conversos. This dynasty was founded by Alvaro in the 1530s and his son Gaspar and Gonzalo, and then his grandsons, Gonzalo and Jorge, carried on the business. They had five ships which regularly made the Sevilla, Cape Verde, America voyage. The Jorges seemed the most powerful consortium in Spanish-American commerce for a time, their interests embracing wax, cloves, mercury for use in the silver mines, wine, and olive oil, as well as slaves. Some of these sayings came from their haciendas at Casilla de la Sierra, wine, and Alameda olives in the Sierra to the north of Sevilla and near Granada, respectively. Ironically, these new Christians were in the habit of referring to their old Christian rivals, solid old Castilian families without a drop of Jewish blood, as Negroes. Admoni, Red Ruddy. The Book of Bereshit, Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. And Yahuwah Elohim formed the man out of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils breath of lives, and the man became a living being. Red earth clay is reddish-brown color, an earth tone. You can see white people using these red clay facial masks, and if you didn't know any better, and you didn't have an explanation of it, and you just saw their picture, you'd probably think that they're trying to do blackface. But this is an example of what a red earth tone looks like. If you do a word study of the following three words, Adam, Adom, and Edom, you'll find that all three are spelled exactly the same, Aleph, Dalet, and Mem, with the only discernible difference being in the vowel points. If you were paying attention, you should have noticed that Adom and Edom have the same vowel placement points, but yet are pronounced differently. Adomi means a descendant of Edom. Now you should be able to see that Adam, Adom, Edom, Adomi, and Admoni all share the same root word and are related. Edomoni, an adjective meaning red or ruddy. Shemuel, Aleph, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 12 to 13. And he sent and brought him in, and he was ruddy, with bright eyes and handsome. And Yahuwah said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is the one." And Shemuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the spirit of Yahuwah came upon David from that day and onwards. And Shemuel arose and went to Ramah. The book of Shemuel, Aleph, 1 Samuel, chapter 17, verse 42. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he despised him, for he was a youth, and ruddy, and of handsome appearance. The book of Bereshit, Genesis, chapter 25, verse 25. And the first came out red all over, like a hairy garment. So they called his name Esau. Esau comes from the root word asa, meaning to press or to squeeze. The book of Bereshit, Genesis, chapter 25, verse 30. And Esau said to Jacob, "Please feed me with that same red stew, for I'm weary." That is why his name is called Edom. You should realize now that Edomoni is not referring to people with pale skin, but to the earth tone color of reddish brown. Some key points to remember. Before the 12th century, Sephardic Jews made up the bulk of world Jewry. It is clear that from this time and before World War II that most Europeans believed that all Jews were black or at least had African ancestry and were not white. Sephardic Jews despised sub-Saharan Africans, the true Hebrews, and actively sought honorary white status among the Europeans. Considering that Esau and Jacob are twin brothers and that Hebrew is an Afro-Asiatic language, we would expect to see similar DNA between the two. The bulk of Ashkenazi Jewish males belong to the J. Habler group, which originated in the Caucasus, the oldest sample being found in the country of Georgia. Among modern so-called Jews, E1B1B1 is the second largest haplogroup with roughly 30% of Sephardim and 20% of Ashkenazim belonging to this haplogroup. This is the haplogroup we are looking for. Both Esau and Jacob belong to the E haplogroup, which branched off into different subclades. Jacob's branch splitting off to form the E1B1A, and Esau's branch splitting off to form the E1B1B. The reason why we are seeing E1B1B1 among the Ashkenazi proselytes is because Edom intermixed with them. Before we continue any further, allow me to give you a brief background on the origin of the Ashkenazi proselytes. In the book of Bereshit, Genesis chapter 10, verses 2 to 3, we learn that the sons of Japheth are as follows: Gomer, Magog, Madai, Yawan, Tubal, Meshech, and Tyrus. The sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, and Rapheth, and Togarmah. I will remind you that Ashkenaz is linked back to eastern Turkey, where researchers have found ancient villages with the names Ishkenaz, Eshkenaz, Ashkenaz, Ashkuz, and have also linked the origin of Yiddish to this region. Edom has an ancient connection with Turkey. Besides spreading into all the lands which the Roman Empire occupied, Herod's son Archelaus married the king of Cappadocia's daughter. Later, the Khazars referred to the Byzantine Empire seated in Turkey as Edom, As the Sephardim were expelled from the Iberian Peninsula in 1492, Turkey opened its doors to receive many of them. The connections between Turkey, the Ashkenaz, the origin of Yiddish, the Khazars, the land of Magog, and Edom run deep. Josephus, Jewish Antiquities, Book 1, Chapter 6, Paragraph 1. For Gomer founded those whom the Greeks now called Galatians, Gauls, but were then called Gomerites. Magog founded those that from him were named Magites, but whom are by the Greeks called Scythians. The Ashina were a ruling clan among Turkic peoples. The name Ashina, which is similar to the Ashanas of Turkey, perhaps they were one and the same, is from the Scythian languages of Central Asia and means blue or celestial. In the Turkic, the word for blue is gok or gog and is associated with the east. The Ashina clan seemed to be originally an offshoot of the Scythians, a Turkic tribe living under Scythian rule, who were living in the Xinjiang region of northwestern China. The Ruan Khaganate drove them out of Xinjiang into the Altai Mountains. The Ashina would go on to lead a massive Turkic confederation, which would be known as the Gok Turk Khaganate, or Eastern Turks. The seat of their power resting in the Orkhon Valley of Mongolia. As internal conflicts arose, the Khaganate split into eastern and western halves. The Gok Turk Empire would last into the mid-8th century. After the Western Empire collapsed, the Eastern Empire began to crumble. Branches of the Ashina clan began to move westward into the ancient lands of Scythia, the land of Magog, and would become the Khagans of the Khazars, who would later convert to Judaism. The Khazars were often called Eastern Turks. The Ashina would literally become the Gok, or Gog, of the land of Magog. It shouldn't be a surprise to know that the ancient Georgian and Armenian chroniclers refer to the Khazar Khagan as the king of the north and Khazaria as the land of the north. Author Kessler, The 13th Tribe, page 56. Artemonov holds that the Khazars and other Turkish people were ruled by descendants of the Turka dynasty, the erstwhile sovereigns of the defunct Turk Empire. Zeki Validi suggests that the imperial race or family of notables to which the Khagan must belong refers to the ancient dynasty of the Ashina, mentioned in Chinese sources, a kind of desert aristocracy from which Turkish and Mongol rulers traditionally claimed descent. D.M. Dunlop, The History of the Jewish Khazars, page 37. It is hardly fortuitous that the destruction of the West Turks in 652 to 657, as of the East Turks later, was brought about by a coalition of which the Uyghurs formed part. We now know that the West Turk power was replaced by that of the Khazars not long afterwards. Dunlop, page 30. After mentioning that Heraclius sought an alliance with the Turks from the east, whom they called Khazars, Theophanes says that the Khazars broke through the Caspian gates under their general Zibal. Being second to the Khagan in dignity, Zibal at Tiflis presents his son, a beardless boy, to Heraclius. Later in the account, the Khazars are referred to simply as Turks. Arthur Kessler, The 13th Tribe, pages 45 to 46. Ibn Fadlan's travel report, as far as it is preserved, ends with the words, "The Khazars and their king are all Jews. The Bulgars and all their neighbors are subject to him. They treat him with worshipful obedience." Some are of the opinion that Gog and Magog are the Khazars. Kessler, page 81. At some date earlier than 864, The Westphalian monk Christian Druthmar of Aquitania wrote a Latin treatise, Exposito in Evangelium Matei, in which he reports that there exist people under the sky in regions where no Christians can be found, whose name is Gog and Magog, and who are Huns. Among them is one called the Ghazari, who are circumcised and observe Judaism in its entirety. D.M. Dunlop, The History of the Jewish Khazars, page 114. The Khazars and their king are all Jews. The Sakaliba, that is, the Volga Bulgars, and all who live near them are subject to him. He addresses them as slaves, and they serve him obediently. Some hold the opinion that Gog and Magog are the Khazars. Emmanuel Komaroff, The Travels of Marco Polo, page 101. These in our part of the world are named Gog and Magog, but by the natives, Ung and Mongol, in each of which there is a distinct race of people. In Ung, they are Gog, and in Mongol, they are Tartars. Komaroff, page 30. Disappointed in this attempt, Alexander caused a great wall to be constructed at the entrance of the pass, and fortified it with towers, in order to restrain those who dwelt beyond it from giving him molestation. From its uncommon strength, the pass obtained the name of the Gate of Iron, and Alexander is commonly said to have enclosed the Tartars between two mountains. D.M. Dunlop, The History of the Jewish Khazars, page 192. In that case, it is remarkable that Salom was ordered to proceed to the Caucasus, not directly into Central Asia. The journey was, however, conceived by the Caliph as to the wall of Gog and Magog. Gog and Magog and the wall built by Dhul-Qarnayn, Alexander the Great, to contain them are, of course, mentioned in the Quran. The cryptic passage was at an earlier date explained to mean the Caucasus fortification, dating from pre-Islamic times known as the Wall of Darban. Author Kessler, The 13th Tribe, page 20. The Georgian Chronicle, echoing an ancient tradition, identifies them, Khazars, with the host of Gog and Magog, wild men with hideous faces and the manners of wild beasts, eaters of blood. D.M. Dunlop, The History of the Jewish Khazars, page 4. In favor of Denny's suggestion, it may be said, A, that no satisfactory explanation of the OU vowel in some forms of the name has yet been given, and B, that in ancient Armenian and Georgian, the Khazar Khan is repeatedly referred to as the king of the north and Khazaria as the land of the north, which could be a rendering of the native name. Nathan Ashabel, Pictorial History of the Jewish People, page 130. Apparently nothing the Jews of Khazaria did was sufficient to restrain the emerging power of the Russians. Only several years after the Khagan, Joseph, has written his letter, the Russian princes succeeded in overrunning Itau, the Khazar capital on the Volga. Under Prince Sviatoslav of Kyiv, the Russians raged through all the Jewish towns and cities on the Volga, ravaging and slaughtering their hated enemies and overlords. In 969, the Khazars were driven out of the entire Caspian Sea region and retreated into the Bosporus region of the Black Sea, where, in a smaller and more compact area, they were able to stem the advance of the invaders. But even that limited power of Khazaria was fated not to endure for long. The Russians, with the help of Byzantium, finally crushed it in 1016, and thus the Jewish kingdom of Khazaria came to an end. Ashubel, pages 130 to 131. What happened to the Khazar Jews is an intriguing historic mystery. It is, however, certain that of those who remained in Khazaria, most were baptized by force. The rest were dispersed. Some of them fled into Hungary, where in time they, too, were absorbed by the local Christian population. To this very day, there are villages in northern Hungary that bear such names as Kozar and Kozardai. It is also widely believed that many Khazar Jews escaping from baptism found their way into Poland. There, by intergroup blending, they soon became indistinguishable from other Jews. Ashabel, page 133. The circumstances surrounding the beginnings of Jewish settlement in Poland remain nebulous. Though it is more than a surmise that the first Jews must have come from the Crimea, after the fall of the Jewish kingdom of Khazaria, they continued to arrive, fleeing from the Russian boyars of Kviv, who, after several centuries of vassalage to the Jewish kings, had finally risen in revolt and conquered them. In time, these Khazar Jews blended with other Jewish elements in Poland and ultimately lost their ethnic group identity. Ashabel, page 231. A forbidding, though invisible, wall began to rise all around the Jewish communities of Russia, the Ukraine, and Poland, beginning with 1772. Jews were forbidden residence in any place outside of the communities they were already living in. This geographic restriction became known as the Jewish Pale of Settlement and was more precisely delimited by statute in 1804. It was, in a matter of speaking, a gigantic ghetto. Those Jews who dared venture beyond its confines were arrested and punished unless protected by special travel and resident permits. The Jewish element already present in Poland when the Khazarian Jews had arrived were the Sephardim, who were driven out of Spain and other European countries that they had lived in. The Khazars intermixed with these black Sephardic Jews and soon became indistinguishable in appearance from one another. A.J. Rogers, Nature Knows No Color Line, page 130. The Eastern Jews who settled in Austria, Poland, and Russia were Negroid too. Count Adam Grosky of Poland, who visited the United States in 1857, said the Jews of his country strongly resembled American mulattoes. Numbers of Jews, he said, have the greatest resemblance to the American mulattoes. Shallow complexion, thick lips, crisp black hair. Of all the Jewish population scattered over the globe, 1/4 dwells in Poland. I am therefore well acquainted with their features. On my arrival in this country, America, I took every light-colored mulatto for a Jew. Ferdinand LaSalle and Morrissey Gottlieb are two examples of mixed-type Polish Jews who were alive at the time when Count Adam Gorski of Poland, in his own words, upon visiting America in 1857, said of them that they strongly resembled the American mulattoes with their shallow complexion, thick lips, and crisp black hair. Morrissey Gottlieb was a Polish Jew and realist painter of the Romantic period. He was born to a wealthy family that spoke both Yiddish and Polish. In my opinion, Morrissey Gottlieb and Colin Kaepernick are historical doppelgangers. In my opinion, another historical doppelganger is that of Ferdinand LaSalle and Gregory Hines. A.J. Rogers, Nature Knows No Color Line, page 130. Karl Marx, who bore a strong resemblance to Frederick Douglass, undoubtedly came of this Negro stock. His nose was broad, his hair was frizzy, and his color so dark he was called the Moor. Negro strain was even more evident in Ferdinand LaSalle, aristocratic founder of socialism. Marx, his rival, called him a Jewish nigger, a greasy Jew from Breslau, who was always concealing his woolly hair with all kinds of hair oil and makeup. In a letter to Engels, March 7, 1856, he said of LaSalle, "It is perfectly obvious from the shape of his head and the way his hair grows that he is descended from Negroes." Key points to remember. The Sephardic Jews were comprised of Edomites and Sidonians and were originally black before intermixing with the Europeans. The Sephardim were kicked out of nearly every country they ever lived in. The Khazars were a confederation of Turkic peoples who lived in the land of Magog and were ruled by the Ashina, also known as the Gok clan. The Khazars converted to Judaism around the middle of the 8th century. Early in the 11th century, the Khazarian cognate collapsed, and many Khazars fled into the Slavic belt, making their way to Poland and surrounding countries. There, they intermixed with the Sephardim and soon became indistinguishable from one another.
I saw her the day she came in the gym. Mm.
Y'all met in the gym?
Yeah. She was so fine.
What was it like marrying a black lady? You white?
Well, Jewish. We're the original black people. Let me school you. Adam was a black man.
My
Abraham
Jewish
was
husband.
A black man. Married to a black woman.
I never thought I would marry outside of my nationality. But she's Dominican. I'm all the way black.
I think we're the carbon copy of you guys. I think we're the carbon copy of you guys. I think we're the carbon copy of you guys.
In America, there was a slave trade. And a lot of the slaves, a very high percentage of them, came from Western Nigerian ports. And in America today, you see a very large movement of African Americans who say that they're the real chosen people, that they're the children of Israel, they're the Judeans. You know, so what are they just trying to create an identity for themselves because they were slaves, or is there really something here? And the answer is most likely there is something there. And most likely, maybe that they were the original Israelites, and maybe that the Jewish people today who are white Caucasian people came in a little bit later on.
Oh, they got the raw end of the deal, didn't they? Look at BA, looks like a huge banana.
Thank you.
Good morning, my friend.
Good morning.
Rabbi Binky Rabinowitz?
What passport did I give you?
You're from Tanzania. My mother's from Tanzania.
Oh, shit.
I don't have it.
Umezali wababa.
Bwana. Unaongea Swahili.
Converting.
Station 6.
Judaism. So
right. Let's get ready to move. There's three to my right.
There's two behind me and one at the northeast edge.
Ndio Bwana. Umezali wa Zanzibar.
Natoka huko, habari gani ndugu?
Nzuri sana.
Shalom.
Baba yangu alikuwa mwalimu wa Kiingereza hapo Zanzibar.
Smart
art.
Wonderful. Telling us a life story.
Asante sana.
Tutu anana.
There is a guy.
You speak Swahili?
You down?
Hey, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Is the sheik black?
He's an Arab.
Well, that's black, isn't it?
Well,
I don't know, maybe it's a dumb question, but I'm just wondering.
So why are you asking?